Hello and welcome. This is Alchemist X. So we are back to Tagatame. It's almost done, but just a little bit more to go. This is going to be the video I mentioned about going over kind of the history of my account. It's also going to have the final summoning that I'm going to do. But first, some real quick news. There was a live stream that the producer did. There's some gifts for that. Nothing too crazy, like 5k gems and some other stuff. And they also made the announcement that there's going to be some kind of Tagatame companion app. No idea if it'll be any good or if it'll be more like that POTK NFT game, which I'm already pretty sick of. No idea. It seems like it might not even happen, but that was something that they talked about in the live stream. Right here, I'm basically knocking out what's probably going to be one of the final milestones that I get in this account, which is the completion of Kudenstein's Link version. He was a unit that I just got randomly. It ended up working out pretty well. I got a lot of usage out of him in the final months of this game's lifetime, so pretty happy with that. So Kudenstein's always been a favorite of mine, so it's a good way to close out. So next thing is going to be the final summoning, and then after that we'll go over my unit acquisition history. Alright, here we are at the banners for one final time. So real quick, before jumping into the summons, I did want to talk about the server shutdown time. So 3 p.m. Japanese standard time. So just whatever time zone you're in, just keep that in mind. For me, I'm 17 hours behind Japan, so that's going to be tomorrow at 10 p.m. So if you're trying to knock out any last things like recordings, screenshots, etc., just keep that in mind that it won't necessarily be on the 28th for you. It's just 28th for Japan. So let's look at the units that I'm going for. This is all very low stakes for fun. These are six units that I don't have. There might be one or two other units that I don't have that are available to choose on here, but those were the six that I just picked out. Out of all of them, Mikoboshi is probably the only one I would actually raise in an attempt to use for like a day. Everyone else is just kind of for collection's sake, just to say like, oh, how many of the available units did I end up getting at the end of the game's life. I have to admit, I am not going to miss this style of banner, just because as nice as the consolation prize is, like, I just don't like how far you can go into it to see just like yellow circles like this over and over again, and just like how far below the standard rate it can end up going. So just go ahead and skip that, and then it happens more often than I would like, but yeah, okay, so we got a pretty good result there. That arguably the best that I've gotten thus far from this banner since it released at the beginning of announcing EOS. I've had a few different lineup changes. Eventually, I changed my mind and just went pure collection rather than thinking about characters that I was going to raise, because after a while, it's like, well, there's no future, so raising the characters isn't really important anymore, but I'd say in a vacuum, Mikoboshi was probably the best. The funniest was definitely Emil, though, just because... Okay, I'll tell you what my plan was going to be. If I never got Emil from this, I was going to burn a couple of Gluttony Reliefs, because I have, or had at least 140 shards of Emil total, and I have a couple of mementos of her, one of which I've naturally pulled a couple of times, the one that comes with her, like, kind of autumn-looking skin. And with a few Gluttony Reliefs, I could get myself 10 shards of hers, and then I was going to transmute her and have her be the final unit. But I ended up getting her anyway. But it was late enough. It was like in early November, so it was a little too late for me to care about trying to do the Emil Link. So even though I finally did get both Link Emil and regular Emil, I just decided it wasn't worth the trouble to raise either of them. So that selector that we got to fully max out a unit, I used it on Dark Mirror instead. I still wanted a water unit, and I have a fully maxed out Nyx, and now I have a fully maxed out Dark Mirror, so that's not quite the twins, but close enough. So yeah, everything else has been pretty bad, but if it's four steps total, three of them are garbage, and one of them is gonna be a decent pull, that's not too bad. I'd consider the standard for like good or at least okay would be one featured every five steps. That's very, very close to the standard rate. I have to admit, I am not going to miss this style of banner where the possibility, you know, as good as the consolation prize is, the possibility to dip way, way below the stated pull rate. Definitely not going to miss that. So we actually did get a red here, but who knows if it'll be featured or not. But that's one thing about Sword of Convalari I do really like. I you know, it's not a perfect game, nor is it a perfect gacha system, but the fact that it keeps you at 2% minimum, so it actually is correct in that you have at least a 2% chance for like highest rarity characters, I think that is a huge quality of life improvement. Definitely something that this game could have used with all of its all of its really bad RNG moments. Okay, so here's the final red. And it is Emma. Okay, so yeah. The first result was the best in that case. That's okay. There's not really much cause to be happy or sad. This is just burning the last of the gems, seeing what happens. Okay, quick sharp turn. Change of plans. Real quick. I just realized a couple of things. One is that I'm very, very close to an elemental milestone mission. Two, after the gem rebate, I was almost exactly 250 gems away from being able to do one more pull, and the elemental milestone is going to give 250 gems. And as an added bonus, I can show off my general use Thunder Auto Team. So it's got the freshly finished Kudenstein in it, Yomi, who's been done for a while, Orion, who I have as maxed out as I can, and then Claris, who I've also had heavily invested for a very, very long time. In most cases, they're able to get the job done, barring real specific mechanics. You know, if I need, like, debuff protection, I might swap in Inuku. If I need a lot of healing, I might use Meifang instead. It really depends on the damage type, but in most situations, a couple of slash units, a pierce unit, and a magic unit with fairly little defensive support besides what's naturally baked into their kits is gonna be enough, and you know, that is that. So I have to say, out of all the altar class in the game, Orion is definitely my favorite for a few reasons. One, it was already built on a rock solid foundation, so even if it had been only okay, you still would have gotten a really good unit out of it, but it was definitely more than okay. Some of the changes they made, I like the permanent buffs that he can get from using his drain attack, which is, it just heals him for an absurd amount, so you don't have to worry about regen. It's just the ability to quicken himself and just drain a bunch and then have a kill snowball on top, so it doesn't really matter if it's a long map or not. As long as there's multiple enemies he can drain from, you're pretty much good no matter what. So it's nice that he got kind of a second life, because in, you know, in this original version I used a lot in global, and then you know, in JP we had the altar classes and he got to become a mainstay unit once again. Okay, so now all that's left to do is just grab that milestone real quick and then jump into the summon screen. I have to admit, I did enjoy the altar class system quite a bit. The only unfortunate thing I think was the scarcity of the tokens themselves. There's a lot of units that I just passed on because it didn't seem worth the risk or the investment, because like, what if a really, really good one like Orion's came out? So I just wish they'd been more plentiful. I don't really think there was a reason to gatekeep that. It was just, you know, in the end it doesn't matter too much, but it definitely could have been a lot more fun to just do everyone. Okay, now let's jump back into the summon screen. So this well and truly is the final summon, because after this, it's very, very unlikely I would get enough to do another pull, and I don't really have the inclination to do it anymore after this, so let's see what color the final circle is going to be. And we've got another red. It might just be another Emma like last time, but who knows. Again, there's not really a win condition here, because, like, what, get 100 shards of Mikaboshi or one of the other units that I didn't end up getting? Who knows? But I am curious to see what the last thing is going to be, because right now Mikaboshi is the final entry in the list, but it's Kubera. All right, Kubera is the final unit acquired. It's kind of cool. I might test him a little bit in the final bit of the game. I should have a ton of elemental shards, so it's not really a big deal. Even if I don't have much to use him for, I could maybe buy some shards in the shop, but it wouldn't be enough to really get him going. I'm trying to remember if I have his memento or not. I think I do. Oh man, it's been a while since I've even seen him in a battle. I know he's fairly tanky. He has the Vermeo style thing. I don't remember if it's half health or if he would have died. I want to say half health, but he gets that super power up thing. I'm a little curious. It really depends on if I have time though, because time really is running out at this point. So yeah, that is the final summon. We got Kubera. You know, he reminds me of the Admiral from Monster Hunter World. Okay, so now let's really get into my unit history. And here we are way back at the beginning of my account. This would have been in early 2023. Also, if you're wondering what the red exclamation point on the transmute button is, it is Justin, and yeah, we're not doing that. So here's how this is going to work. I don't have enough time to just scroll across the, you know, couple hundred units and, you know, talk about everyone or even talk about whatever's noteworthy as a pass. That would just be too long and too unfocused. So here's what I got. We're going to scroll through it twice. We'll start negative and we'll end positive. So I'm going to do the top five regrets and then my top five kind of game changers or noteworthy things. So my very first regret is going to be a little bit farther down because a lot of good stuff happened at first because, you know, I did reroll. But then after that, I ended up doing another banner that was like an Ouroboros and Ouroboros variant themed, and that's how I ended up getting Bianca. It was all duds. Bianca was with a selector and I ended up not really using her all that much, so definitely not the best use of gems insofar as that goes. You know, it didn't end up mattering much in the long run, but it is still a regret. Now, the next regret that I have is Ela. This is a different kind. This is more of the, I'm sad I didn't raise her. I've never been a big fan of her design, but I do actually really like her kit for, like, her altar class. And, like, just anybody who has the snowball-based kit is usually somebody I like. So it's a little unfortunate that I didn't end up getting that for the fire element. Okay, let's just keep on moving. You know, speaking of fire, the number three on my regrets is also going to be that same element, and it's going to be Catanova. Not so much that I regret not raising him, because there would have been a limit to how effective I could have been, especially given my general lack of mementos for him. So just in general, the game kind of told me it's not happening, but the regret is more in the lamenting a future that was not meant to be, in terms of they never made a Link Catanova. I really wanted that. I would have definitely been willing to throw some gems at the game as far as getting caught up on his mementos, stuff like that, if there had been a Link Catanova. So that is unfortunate. All right, let's move on to number four. Number four is going to be our first entry in Phantom of the Kill, and that is going to be Tiferet. Now, as you can see, she is decently raised, but I just didn't end up using her as much as I would have hoped. You know, it's not like I went through an insane trouble to get her, but I still spent a decent amount of gems, both the banner I got her and getting her memento. And of course, that skin is very nice, but she just ended up not being as effective as I would have hoped. You know, she was such a clutch unit in global, but I think I just would have needed a lot more shards of her to really make that happen. No regrets on Lisanot, though. She is awesome, and even though mostly raising her is a passion project, nonetheless, I zero regrets there. And then, oh, you know what? I think I accidentally skipped someone. Yeah, that's a little dyslexia goes a long way, but Kaiser is another one I regret, just because the game threw him at me kind of a lot. As you can see, he's really not quite maxed, but very heavily invested, but there were a couple of maps where I was able to get him buffed and he was able to kill stuff just fine, but like, I don't know, I just feel like I didn't really get my resources worth as far as raising him goes, which is a shame because Neville I used a lot. There's a lot of content where Neville ended up being really, really handy, and I never got around to Vlad. So yeah, that is it for my regrets. So let's go ahead and rewind the clock and spin things in a more positive direction. And then once we get to the final game changer positive thing, it'll be pretty close to the end at that point, and then we can just scroll on and see what the rest of the history looks like. So the very first thing is not one thing, but it's going to range all the way from Legacy Ouroboros, who's kind of my first kind of carry unit that was getting me through the early game. Nero, my first map clear unit. Nimmel, who even before he got his godly upgrade, was very, very effective for clearing early content because I was trying to get through Chapter 5 as fast as I could so I could unlock the EX hard quests. And then, of course, Zaphorus, who was the final element of that beginner banner where I got the three of them and their mementos. Even though my usage of him did decrease a little bit, still very, very good to have. Like, the Zaphorus plus Nidhogg tankiness combo, still something that I've used fairly recently. So that ended up being a very good decision slash good timing to start the game because the anniversary's gifts made that possible. So the next is a little less bombastic and sensational than that, but sometimes it is the like just little things that make a difference. So there were two banners, one from units, one from mementos. For the units, I got Melvili, absolutely essential support unit. Never stopped using her once I got her, so that was really, really nice. I just happened to get her memento too just before that. And then Vermeo, surprisingly, I had heard he was like kind of an okay unit. I ended up getting him just because the economy of a memento selector that also gave me a unit in an element I was trying to strengthen, like, was a good decision in the short run. Ended up being a good decision in the long run too, because he ended up clearing out one of those fairly hard cursed beast quests. Like, him and Adelaide together just double teamed it. So that worked out. Okay, let's move on to the number three, which is going to be a lot more simple. Just Madia. She is really, really strong. The swimsuit skin definitely, you know, didn't hurt at all. But a hyper-invested Madia, really effective all the way through the end of the game. Especially if you combine her in a team with, like, Lindrake, Soul, etc. Lindrake should be on the list, but I'm actually going to leave him out because he was available for the half anniversary. And so, like, everybody was able to get Lindrake. I said, basically, if you don't have Lindrake, get him now. And so I'm assuming anybody that didn't already have him at that point did. And so, like, it's, you know, that's a milestone in everybody's account. So, there's somebody that, you know, of course I have to talk about, right? Because, you know, it's Dios. And, you know, basically once he showed up, he's probably most frequently appearing unit in my account. You know, going back, looking at my channels, the number of times he shows up. Just absolutely, you know, he's hyper-specialized, but pretty much the very best at what he does. And then it helped that, to add to it, Andex, Claybell, Ryza, all of those units were helpful in giving him a team, and I had already had all of them at various levels of investment, so that light team came together really, really well. Like, Dios, Andex, Ryza, flex slot, that got me through so much stuff. So yeah, definitely cannot forget about him. And then immediately after that, I mean, not quite, there's a few months in between, but I had a really bad wind drought. Like, for a while, Najee was, like, my main limited wind unit, and, you know, while he is a very effective unit, he can't do everything. You're in an anti-slash map, and that's that. So, in relatively short order, Mircea, Yggdrasil, and Ultima Link all came together. I ended up getting Smire, and, like, that worked out really, really well. So, that was the end of the wind drought, and that was around the time that Ophinius came out, too. And he was just an absolutely great unit to have. While he was not as influential by himself as Dios, like, him being the fourth member of, like, the Dios and Ex-Riza team worked out really, really well all the time. Every once in a while, solo a map as him. So definitely that was a very, very good time. And as you can see, even though that was quite a while ago, we are most of the way through. So there's a few other influential people that came along, like Azami and Nidhogg. Some Link units like Yaris, Yomi, and then later Kudenstein. Einslink is another one. He's pretty close to the Dios level of Game Changer. The only reason that I didn't put him on my top five is just because by the time he came out, like, the game had already kind of peaked and it was really starting to look like we were on borrowed time, and in fact we were. So, but absolutely excellent unit nonetheless. And then, of course, there's Agatha, who makes me a little bit mad because I went to the trouble of getting her to Hard Pity. And then as soon as the half anniversary happened, I got a free copy of her. But, you know, that happens sometimes. I ended up getting her second memento with the free memento that we got via the coins. Kunstein's another very honorable mention, but again, just too late in the game to, like, really, really count. And then Ouroboros was kind of one of my final projects as far as the game goes. Like, I used the various means that they gave us a lot of free shards to get her as maxed as I possibly could. Although I definitely forgot to equip her second memento. I ended up getting that with the selector from my first round of memento pulls. And then we got to my unfinished Logi, who just, I wish he'd had a little more time, but he's excellent even without having that done. Lisbeth, who I sadly just never really got a chance to. I never finished Lisbeth's job 3, so that just wasn't really in the cards. And then, of course, Emil, who I already talked about. And then Mikaboshi and Kubera, who we witnessed earlier today. So yeah, that is basically the history of my account, abridged. It's been a fun ride. This is not the final video that I'm going to make for Tagatame. I'll probably do one more just for any other miscellaneous thoughts, kind of what went wrong slash what else I enjoyed, things that just didn't fit into the content of this particular video, which is already plenty long. So yeah, if you're doing your final summoning, I wish you good luck, and I will see you all next time.